Good evening. This שיעור בעזרת השם לרפואה שלמה of Gabriel Chaim ben Ala Shimonov and לרפואת משה בן רבקה and הרב שלתיאל מאיר בן אביגיל. And בעזרת השם להבדיל לעילוי נשמת פאשה אסתר בת שלמה and לעילוי נשמת תמרה בת שפרה. Also לרפואת דבורה אלישבע בת שרה. As you probably listening to the news, officially Israel now is in the middle of civil war. There's a civil war. It's a huge miracle that this civil war escalated in the last few months since the right wing won the election. The lefty liberal traders, they cannot handle the results of the election. Just like here, same style with the Democrat. Over here, the Democrat tampered with the election before. Over there, they do it after. That's the only difference. But they both cannot accept the results. They can't accept the verdict. And they decided that if they will not control, let Israel get burned. They don't care. So it escalated more in demonstrations every week, now every day, now every hour, now everywhere in Israel. They block streets, they block highways, they make fire. But there's an unbelievable miracle here that this has been going on for 6 months, and now it's been really, really bad in the last month, and not one person got killed yet. It's unbelievable. You know, if you have riots by the Arabs, 100,000 dead, 50,000 dead, 10,000 dead, Peru, Mexico, every place they have fights, in Chile, tanks on the street, police shoot at people, people get killed. In Iran, forget it, they kill them by thousands, the demonstrators. Here in Israel, now one person got killed. You ask yourself, how can it be? The answer is, one reason is because the police is afraid of them. The police is controlled by lefty traders. And they give them instructions what to do. And the instructions until today was to leave them alone. Not to hurt them. Worst case scenario, to spray water on them. They have a special big car. It shoots water. Big deal in a 95 to 100 degrees, someone who comes to demonstrate and sweat in the humidity of Israel, what's the big deal? He gets some fresh water. If you're too close to the water, it makes you fly. It's really like a missile. I saw today they hit one guy, he flew maybe 7 feet in the air. If you're close, usually they do it from very far. And the righties, they're not violent like the lefties. They made a few demonstrations, everything was peaceful. So there are damages, they make damages to Israel. Israel now financially suffered tremendously. The rating of the state of Israel is about to go down. That means every Israeli that suffer financially will suffer even more because you're gonna have to pay more money for money that the government borrowed. Very simple. They hurt themselves, but they don't care. We'll commit suicide, we'll finish Israel because we are not in charge. That's what's going on right now. And that's exactly what the Torah told us 2,000 years ago in the Talmud, in the Zohar, that before the Mashiach would come, these Erev Rav wicked people will control us fully. And that's what I always say. I say it for years. They control the police, they control the army, they control every courtroom, they control the Supreme Court, they control the newspapers, they control every channel besides Channel 14 that they fight very much to close it. So they control all the media, they control Facebook, they control YouTube in Israel. Everyone cooperate with them. They have the help of the American Democratic Party, which is anti-Israel. Of course, the Europeans support them and send them billions. So basically, they have everything that they need. And they pay money to the people. People get 700 shekel to come demonstrate. Some people get 300, some 700. There's all kinds of versions. Why not to come to demonstrate? You make $200, you stand over there and you scream. That's what they do. But it's not only that. Today, a few days ago, I think maybe when we spoke about it a few days ago, I said that it's just a matter of time until an angry person would drive with his cars into them and kill a few or injured badly, because people are losing their mind. You know, they get stuck 3 hours. They don't want to open the road. You get stuck on the road. You have things to do. Your kids are waiting for you. You have to go to work. You have to go home. Everyone, some people needs to go to the hospital. Some women needed to give birth. They close the road. They don't let. You know? So I say just a matter of time until a person in stress will run into them. First of all, there's a lot of people that are not normal. Second, someone in a serious medical stress will not care. He would like to save his life, so he's going to run into them. Say, I better save my life than their life. And today it happened. Today someone in Kfar Saba saw that they don't let him pass, no matter how much he begged them, let me go, they don't let. He went with his car, started to speed. I don't know, I mean, I can't believe it. If you see the video, you would be sure that at least 5, 6 would die, or at least seriously injured. In the end, they reported that 3 people got injured, minor injuries. Minor injuries meaning broke the hand, broke the leg. It doesn't mean like life risk, you know. But why am I telling you this? When the ultra-Orthodox people, volunteers of Hatzalah, they showed up to the place with ambulance to take care of the injured people, the rest of the lefty traders, these villains, they started to scream to them, parasitim, parasites. They come voluntarily to help them to save their life. They didn't know if they dead, injured, whatever the case. They run voluntarily. Hatzalah is volunteers. They come to help them out, and the people that are not injured in their face, like Nazis, just like the Nazis in the 1930s, 40s in Germany, they scream to the religious people, parasites, parasites. I wonder who gives permission, according to the Torah, to go and help the health of the enemies of Hashem? That's a big question. That's a big question. Few people that came to me and asked me if they should go to medical school, I say in my opinion, I say, listen, simple common sense. You'll become a doctor. Who are the patients you will have to treat? If you're in a liberal state like California or New York or Tel Aviv, 98 or 99% of the people you will have to take care of are extremely wicked. People that according to the Torah, not my opinion, according to the Torah, do not deserve to live. Mechalelei Shabbat, gays, Nazis, racists, traders, people who make, go against their own people, tell the world what to do to hurt us, all kinds of people like this, all kinds of Jew haters, all kinds of Arab terrorists, all kinds of Muslim radical that support terrorism. So you, the Jewish doctor, from morning to night, will have to take care of one patient after the other that God cannot stand for a nice salary. No, let's say you make $1 million. It's a big question. If that's the job you should look for, this is what you have to do. You have people that hate religion, people that will burn the Torah in a second, people with swastika in Israel, all kind of Ukrainian Nazis that went to Israel, got money from the Israeli government, and right away make a damage to the country with their ideology. They come to a doctor, Israeli doctor, they take off their shirt, they see that they shave hair, swastika all over, pictures of Hitler. And then now you have to take care of them now. You have to give him a shot, you have to give him a treatment, you have to operate on him. Now you're going to help him to leave. When what is he going to do? Go back to hurt more Jews. Or the gay, go back to his husband to control, to continue to do, to commit the most despicable sins against God, which is, according to the Torah, a punishment of a permanent cut for the soul, karet, and death by stoning. There's no worse punishment in the Torah than this. So you have to take care of him. If you're in Tel Aviv, 8 out of 10 people are like this. Those are the people, they all live there. They're going to come to you and you have a clinic over there. You're going to have to take care of them from morning to night, just like in downtown Manhattan and just like in San Francisco. And that's what you're going to have to do. And then one day you come to Hashem. First problem you're going to have, you didn't learn Torah. You were not religious enough. You have to pay for all your sins. And then you will have to explain why for 40 years you dedicated your life to help people that hate God, hate His Torah, hate His children, and did everything they can to get Him angry. Do you hear the common sense of what I say or no? So why people would like to be doctors? Two reasons. One reason is greed. It's good pay. And one reason is they want to help people. Sometimes it's both. He would like to have a job helping people, ease their pain, help them to live, improve the quality of their life, but only in one condition, that he's going to make millions of dollars and live the life. One without the other, he doesn't agree. He won't agree just to make millions but not to be productive to society, which is nice. And he doesn't want to help society without making millions. If you give them both, he's very happy, but he lives in illusion. He doesn't help society. He damaged the world. And that's, we're living in a very, very serious conflict here. I want to make a living, and I have to find a job that doesn't get God angry. For instance, if I'm a reporter for New York Times, all day I have to write against religion, because otherwise you get fired. You have to promote abortions. You have to promote gay marriage. You have to speak against Israel. You have to speak against the Republicans, against anything that want to do something right in this world. All day, you throw poison at them. Your entire career, what kind of a life is this? This is for us to understand what's going on here. So I gave an advice to some people, and some of them took my advice. You know, you're right, I never looked at it that way. I'm going to be a servant of all kinds of Nazis and all kinds of Muslim terrorists and all kinds of idol worshippers from India and from other countries who bow down to the cow, or all kinds of Nazis that would like to burn us all alive. I'm going to have to take care of them. Same thing, lawyers. Lawyers, same thing. You're a defense lawyer. Who's going to come to you? Religious Jews from the yeshiva? Most likely they won't. No one is perfect. You may find one or two that will come to you. But most of the people you have to protect are monsters who hurt other people, hurt good people, hurt innocent people. You're going to defend them for $200,000-$300,000 as a criminal lawyer. You put back this monster on the street to hurt more kids, to hurt more women, to hurt more Jews, to hurt more innocent people, to rob, to steal credit cards, to get people into horrible problems, to freeze their bank accounts. Do you know how many people like this you have? Who wants a job like this? Who wants a job like this? The main reason is the greed. I promise you, if they would make a law that lawyers don't make more than $50,000 a year and doctors don't make more than $50,000 a year, I doubt if you're going to have 10 Jews a year that would like to be lawyers and doctors. 10 a year, I would not believe that they would agree. No one would agree. And that's what the Yetzer Hara does. The most despicable jobs are the most earned income. Why? Otherwise, if you have a business, the busiest day will always be Shabbat. Always. No matter where you live. Israel, the most busy day. People have off. The store is booming. Manhattan, same story. Anywhere you go, weekend, 2 days weekend, people like Saturday to do shopping. So what do you think? If Saturday no one would come, who would have a test? Every Jew would like to close his business, even the secular. In Israel, some people work, so Shabbat, they want to be with the family. Why they open the store? Because they make on Shabbat more than what they make in 6 days. So they open the business. Restaurants, entertainment places, and you know, all these places, the malls, some of them. And that's what's going on. So now, why the mess in Israel? What is it about? Someone asked me, can you explain what really happened right now? Why today they go crazy more than any other day? The answer is, Rabotai, there is something in Israel that the government today passed finally a law, first law finally they passing, that drove the leftists crazy. It's called Bitul Chok HaSvirut. Svirut means probability, logical probability, according to the opinion of the judge. Now listen to this unbelievable dictatorship. Unbelievable. The judges in Israel, 30 years ago, there was one very wicked judge, the head of the Supreme Court, Aaron Barak, Shem Reshaim Irkav. Today is almost 90. He decided everything from now on can be brought to the court. Doesn't have to be criminal, doesn't have to be civil, anything. You don't like the face of your neighbor, you can sue him. You don't like your parents, you can sue them. You drink coffee, you didn't like the taste, you can sue them. Anything, you can sue anyone, anywhere, and the court has the right to decide whatever they want. Okay. The problem is that we have laws, secular laws. It's all written by the state. And the judge make himself now above the law. Meaning, lo savir be'enai. It doesn't make sense according to my political views. It doesn't make sense according to my political agenda. It doesn't make sense based on my common sense. You want it, I don't like it. But who cares what you like? You're supposed to follow the rules of the state. No. I still have the right to cancel the lawsuit because I don't think that something like this makes sense. Why? I hate religion, and that's my opinion. I give you one example. They have a law in Israel, you're not allowed to open your businesses on Shabbat. This law is 7 years old. 7 years old. There's a letter from Mayor Dizengoff, the first mayor of Tel Aviv. It's complete secular, not religious. He wrote a letter. I ask all the businesses in Tel Aviv to respect the law. Please, no one should be mechalel Shabbat in Faresia. No one should violate the rules of Shabbat in public. Therefore, no one should ever open the business. It's against the law. That's the law. Now, today, everyone does whatever they want. Nobody gets fined. Nobody cares. The judges come to eat there on Shabbat. They have no problem. Now, the soccer players, they say, we don't want to play on Shabbat. A lot of us want to be religious. We want to play Sunday, Monday. Why do we have to play on Shabbat? They take it to court. The players don't want to play on Shabbat. The judge say, bring it to court. The judge say, you have to play on Shabbat. But it's against the rules. It's against the law of Israel. It's very unlikely now to cancel sports on Shabbat. People wants to come, they have a day off, you must play. But it's against the rule. It's against the rules. He doesn't say, okay, go change the law, that I'll be able to rule differently. No, I don't care about the law. I decide you must play on Shabbat. I decide you must bring chametz into the hospitals in Pesach. You cannot tell people not to bring chametz. But for 67 years, that's the way it was. We don't care. It's not severe. We need to build a wall. There are terror attacks every hour. Arabs coming in and kill people. They started to build a wall. One lefty appealed to the court. They say the government decided to build a wall. The government is nothing. I decide. Take down the wall. Do you know how expensive this wall was? Big cement wall. Maybe 20, 30 feet high. All towards the areas of the Arabs that they won't be able to come in and kill people. The day they took a part of the wall, meaning to give them access, a few hours later they came and shot 4 people and killed them. He makes the rules. He doesn't care about the government. Meaning the government is worthless. The government can make rules. The government can decide. The government can vote. One judge in Tel Aviv, I don't like it. It's against the law. The law is, doesn't make sense. Times has changed. I think you should not do it. I rule against it. There's nothing you can do. So today, finally, they passed a law that judges cannot judge based on their hunch or based on their opinions or based on political opinions. You cannot do it. Just because you're a Democrat, you're going to rule in a case against the person that is Republican? You have to rule according to the evidence. So a lot of people now are happy in Israel. Finally, I say it's baloney. The judges will continue to do whatever they want. They control everything. There's nothing you can do. They will continue, if they ignore the laws, they will ignore these laws as well. They're not going to change. So why people are happy? So I spoke to some people today in the government. I asked them, why are you so happy? You know it's all baloney. So the answer is, we know very well that these lefties don't care about rules, they don't accept anything, they do whatever they want, it's anarchy. We know it. But one thing we also know, that if today they would make the right not able to vote against what they wanted to vote, that would be the end of all the rights in Israel for good. That's it. There's no point of running to vote in the election at all, ever again. Because no one will vote anymore for the right, because the right doesn't have any power. They can't even pass a law, one law. Every law they want to pass, they burn Israel. There's nothing you can do. So it was very important to pass the law today, even though in reality it's not going to change anything for the better. But before they passed the law, half of the pilots of the Air Force announced that they do not come. They're on strike. They don't come for training in the Air Force. The F-16 pilots, F-15, F-35. The pilots that fly every day, they must be, you know, in good shape. They refuse to come to training. A lot of generals, we don't come anymore to the army. The head of the union, we will make all Israel go on strike. No services, no garbage, nothing. No, we freeze the country. That's blackmail. That's anarchy. So, Rabotai, this is the situation we live in. Anyone would ever dream such thing a year ago? The beginning of all of that, there was 4 elections. You cannot form a government. Then they form a government of traders with the Arab Muslim brothers, who fell after 1 year. And since then, finally, they were able to make a government with 64 members that supposedly are on the right, even though many of them are lefties as well. But they are declared as righties. And since then, that government cannot pass one law. Every time they just talk about something they want to change, riots on the street. And they don't give up. 6 months, almost every day, every place, every highway, every street. You don't even know if you can fly to Israel. You're going to pay $1,800 now for a flight. The day of the flight, they shut the airport. Or they closed the highway, you cannot get into the airport. They did it already a few times. People couldn't get to the flight. They blocked the area. Not only that, today when there was the vote today, they went and locked the areas where the members of the Knesset live, that they won't be able to leave their house. Hundreds of people waiting by the government member next to his house. You come out, we'll kill you. That he won't be able to come to vote. These are the lefties. These are the dirty Erev Rav that the Zohar told us about 2,000 years ago. Now you see how unbelievable this prophecy was. Those are the dirty souls that Moshe Rabbeinu took out of Egypt and made them join the Jewish nation. And the Zohar said, are we going to cry about this every generation? They're going to betray us. They will cooperate with our enemies. It's a cancer inside the heart of the country, inside the heart of the Jewish nation. Every generation we're going to suffer from them, but the end will be unbearable with them, what they're going to do. Then Mashiach would come, and the end of all these haters of Hashem will come. But until it will happen, we're going to have to suffer tremendously. Tremendously. It's very possible now that the enemies of Israel that are enjoying now, today Nasrallah, the head of the Hezbollah, said Israel is falling apart. Today was the worst day in the history of the state of Israel. Very possible that is right. Talking and talking and talking, when they realize that the traitors don't come to serve in the army, they would invite them to attack us. I want to remind you, they have 100,000 missiles aimed to every street in Israel. If they know that the pilots are not coming already 1 week, 2 weeks, 5 weeks to train, and they're not in shape, and they refuse to come, in one shot you're going to get 20,000 missiles on you in one day. What are you going to do? Till now they're afraid. They're afraid that the pilots will come and attack them and blow up their entire place. That's why they don't shoot those missiles. But if they know they're on a strike, if you now want to rob a bank and they have a guard over there, and then the guard decided that he's going on a strike for 3 days, when will you go to rob the bank? When the guard is there or when he went to sleep? You got the point or no? So that was just a little bit review for all the people who asked to explain what's really happening. We will see, Bezrat Hashem. We started on Shabbat, Sefer Dvarim, Deuteronomy. Ele Advarim, Ele, Aleph is 1 in numeric value, Lamed is 30, A is 5, Ele Advarim, 36, Ele, 36. These were the last 36 days of the life of Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu passed. What was his age? 120 years exactly. Not a day more, not a day less. He was born in Zayin Be'Adar, and he passed in Zayin Be'Adar, 120 years later. 120 years exactly complete. Not 1 hour is missing. That was the life of Moshe Rabbeinu. But 36 days before he passed, he started to speak to the nation and prepare them for what's coming. He reminds them about everything that happened until now in the last 40 years since we came out of Egypt. He hints to them in his speech right now in all the places where they committed sins and blame them for the fact that him and Aaron did not enter the land of Israel because of Mei Meriva, because of the demonstrations they made when there was no war there. And this is what we read before the day of Tisha B'Av. Tisha B'Av, the 9 days of Av. The 9 days of Av is the worst day of the year in a Jewish calendar. Both temples were destroyed in that date. Both temples, and we read Megillat Echa. That's going to be, the fast is starting Wednesday night. It's a very long fast, even longer than Yom Kippur, because the sunset is later. Yom Kippur will be probably almost an hour earlier. Even though it's the same amount of hours, but when you go to sleep, the day, or the next day, which is the hardest day, become a little bit shorter on Yom Kippur. But on Tisha B'Av is very long. The fast starts from the night. And it's strict. It's not like the other fast that starts in the morning and finish in the evening. You know, even pregnant women fast. It's a complete day of fast. So the מגילת אחד, we read, we sit on the floor and we cry, and we cry for the destruction of the temple, not just for the destruction of the temple, for the fact that the temple is not being rebuilt in our days, it means it's our fault. That's what the Gemara say. Every generation that the temple was not rebuilt by them, it means that they are the reason that Hashem could not build the temple. Now we are a few days before Tisha B'Av, and the temple, the second temple, was destroyed because of baseless hatred, sinat chinam, and for 2,000 years is not getting rebuilt. Why? Very simple. The sinat chinam did not stop. It only got worse. Now is the worst sinat chinam we have. The worst it's ever been. Since the destruction of the temple, now in Israel, it's the most anti-Semite place on earth. Half of the people behave like Nazis in their ideology. They hate religious people, they hate real Jews, they want to turn Israel into a state of goyim. Those are the people, and they're very violent, as you see, and very dirty in their behaving. It's not regular behaving. So, with this kind of half and half situation, what are the odds that the temple will be built? The answer doesn't exist. There's no chance. As the way it is right now, we can forget about the temple. The temple can only build based on a prophecy, only after Hashem will clean all the wicked people from the world, that's when the temple can be built. Because right now, think about it, if you want to build the temple, these lefty Libras will die and not let you build the temple. The last thing they want to see is sacrifices, that you bring sheep and goats and sacrifice them in the altar. All these animal rights activists, they will block the way. You won't be able to do anything. Immediately they run to the Supreme Court. How do you let them build Beit HaMikdash? It cannot be. They'll send the army. They send the police. They'll begin to arrest all kinds of rabbis. That's what they do anyway right now. They'll do it 10 times worse. There's no way to build a temple. If you want to build now a temple, thousands of people will die in a war over it. These lefties will never allow it. Especially when they love the Arab Hamas so much, and that's gonna be for them to die for this Hamas terrorist. What, you wanna build a temple where the Arab have the mask? You wanna clean the mask from the Moriah Mountain above the Western Wall? What, are you normal? They're gonna run to the United Nations, they will run to the United States. No one will let you build the temple. No one. There is zero chance to build the temple as long as half of the people in Israel are extremely wicked. You can dream until tomorrow. There's not going to be a temple. Only the Mashiach will be able to build it. That's the prophecies. Nothing. Now it's clear why. There's no chance to do it. You can only do it after Hashem will fulfill this pasuk, letaken olam b'malchut shaddai. לתקן עולם במלכות שדי. That's it. Other than that, there's no other way. So the question now, until then, we're going to have to continue to mourn and Tisha B'Av and read Megillat Echa. What does it mean, Echa? A, Aleph Yud, Ko. A, Ko. If you remember, two, 3 years ago, I gave a lecture about that the world is built in 3 different levels. The entire world, every place you walk, Paris, London, New York, Africa, everywhere you walk, the streets are, the ground is level zero. Level zero, like they call ground zero in the Twin Towers. The entire world is ground zero. The upper world is level 50. 50 gate of wisdoms. Here, level zero. The upper world, level 50. And there's only one place in the world that it's level 25 on this earth. Where is it? The Moriah Mountain in Jerusalem. That's where the temple was. That's what Abraham said to Yitzchak. And he said to Ishmael and the donkey, Shvu lachem po im ha-chamor,
ואני והנער נלכה עד כה. Sit here together with the donkey, and me and the boy will go to כה. Doesn't make any sense in Hebrew. What does it mean, we'll go to כה? כה, it's 25. Half, it's 20. A, it's 5. Me and the boy will go to the place that it's called כה. Why is it called, why it's the name of it is called? We will explain in a minute. So Avraham takes Yitzchak to the Akedah. That's also later on David HaMelech bought the area from a goy named Arvana Hayevusi. There was a rich goy. He owned the property there. And David came and bought it from him for full price. Why? That the Jews will own the place that was theirs anyway. What is it like? Imagine in Auschwitz, the Jews that were released by the Russian, they came out of the camp and they went back to the house and they saw that that Polish goyim stole their house and they lived there. They were in the camps for a few years. They came back to the house and they see a Polish family living there. That's what happened. So they say to them, give us back the homes, get lost. Get out of here or we kill you. And what do? They take axes and split their heads open. Many of the survivors, after all they've been through, then when they came back to the place, the Polish came after them and killed them right there. They asked them later, why did you do such thing? They say, we couldn't even think about them coming back into power in a business. They've been controlling us in the business, these Jews, for so many decades. Thinking about them coming and taking over the economy and the businesses like it was before the Nazis killed them, we couldn't take that risk. We had to kill them. The real reason is because they just wanted to steal the property. Who wants to give all the houses back? They have thousands of homes they stole. Now imagine if one of the Jews had some money that he hid somewhere. He would come back to the Polish thief and say, I want to buy back my house in Warsaw. And he will pay him, according to today's market, $500,000, and buy back his own house. That the Polish will vacate the house, that he'll be able to move back in. That's what happened with David HaMelech. He comes to this goy, he has the deed for the Moriah Mountain. I want to buy it from you. Paid him top money to buy the place that we should build the first temple. Remember, until David HaMelech, there was no temple. The only temple we had was a temporary one. It's called the Mishkan that we took with us for 40 years in the desert from place to place. It was a temporary temple. You take it apart and you build it. You take it apart and you build it. Where is this Mishkan today? Where is it? Shlomo HaMelech buried it under the temple he built. So if you go now up to the Temple Mount, which is not allowed, by the way, Jews are not allowed to go up there. It's a Safek Isur Karet. There are areas over there that could be Kodesh HaKodeshim. We are all impure. We all touch dead bodies, or we're in cemeteries, or people died in a hospital when we were there, or we drive on a highway and could be old graves under the highways from hundreds of years ago. Everyone is tmemet. We have the dead body impurity. And you're not allowed to go into Kodesh HaKodeshim. First, you're not a Kohen, and second, you're not Taor, you're not pure. Going there in this status make your soul be cut permanently from the afterlife. Isur Karet. That's why we're not allowed to go up. When Ariel Sharon, the Prime Minister of Israel, decided to go up to the Temple Mount, that day the Intifada started. Hundreds of people died. Thousands of people died. Months of war with the Palestinian terrorists. They just did not want to let go. Why? Because he came up with a few other politicians into the yard over there where the Arabs are. To show them we own the place. That was the whole idea.
and it brought on us hundreds of death, a lot of problems. We're not allowed to go up there. But when the Mashiach come, and we're going to, Baruch Hashem, have a clean world, if we survive, if we'll be righteous, one of the things he will do is slaughter the red cow. There is a red cow in Israel ready. They have a kosher red cow right now in Israel, supervised 24/7. Why? Because no one is allowed to sit on it. No one is allowed to put any weight on it. If you take a bottle of water and you put on the back of the cow, that's it. It becomes obsolete. Can't use it. So they have to supervise this red cow. I saw a picture of that red cow, beautiful red cow. It's dark red, close to brown. Doesn't have two black hairs. They check with magnifying glass the entire cow, not to have two black hairs. Two black hairs makes it not kosher. Has to be all red. And we already have the red cow. We just now need the Mashiach to come. Once the Mashiach come, I will take the red cow. In history, we had 9 red cows. The next red cow will be the final one, the 10th one. Once you slaughter the red cow and you mix it with the hyssop and you mix it with the water from Nikvat HaShiloach, the water there by the Kotel, natural spring water of the Nikvat HaShiloach, the tunnel that King Chizkiyahu dug, and they met together. It's from two sides. They met, mamash, unbelievable. They didn't have the equipment we have today. You know, so they actually work with hands, with hammers. It took who knows how long to make such thing. And finally they met in order for them to bring water into the old city. So they take water from there. They take hyssop, they take the red cow, they burn the red cow, they take the ashes, they mix it. And that's going to purify all the people that are tmei metim, that are impure. But until it will happen, no one is allowed to go up there. So, Rabotai, Moshe now is giving us a hint in a parasha, in his speech, in the opening of his speech. Echa esa levadi torchachem umasaechem verifchem. Echa, in simple Hebrew, means where? Just like Hashem said to Adam HaRishon, Ayeka, where are you? Echa, where or how? More accurate, how? Echa means like ech. Ech ani aseh et zeh? How will I do it? How many times Echa appears in the Tanakh? The word Echa. In the prophet Yeshayahu, Isaiah 1, verse 21, this is the part we read in Tisha B'Av, Echa ita lezona kirya ne'emana. How the land of Israel and the city of Jerusalem, you know, lost all their holiness, and the goyim comes and they do whatever they want over there. Now murderers took over. That's what the prophet said 2,600 years ago, after the destruction of the first temple. So in Megillat Echa, we have another verse. It's also part of the Tanakh. Echa yashva badad, ha'ir rabati. How the greatest city in the world is so neglected now and destroyed. So that's two times Echa. What's the connection between this Echa? Remember, it's two words. A, ko. Aleph Yud, one word. Chaf A, another word. When Avraham got the promise from Hashem, Hashem took him out to watch the stars. And he said to him, that's how your descendants going to be. They multiply to be millions of people that will come out of you. In the next generations, the prophets came to Hashem with complaint. The prophets. They asked Hashem, where is the promise that you promised us? Echa, ko. Where is the ko? You say to Abraham, ko yezaracha. Your children will be millions. And they ask, where is it? They keep killing us. The goyim keep killing us. Ko yezaracha. So the prophet started to scream. In Yalkut Gershoni, it says like this. Midrash Rabbah brings the words of Rabbi Levi in the name of Rabbi Yochanan.
a person walk, started to walk to his journey on you know, on his way for 10 days. There is no motel and no restaurant the entire 10 days. Nothing to eat, nothing to drink. Not even one tree to hide from the sun. Not even a little lake of water to get some water. All of a sudden he see one tree from far away after 10 days of walking. Once he come near the tree, he got very happy. He saw that the tree have a spring water under, that's where he gets his water from, because there's no rain in the desert. Water coming from the ground there. So he saw, you know, that I have now a tree to hide, and I have water to drink. It's a wonderful thing. He sat under the branches of the tree, drank from the water, spring water, ate from the fruits of that tree. When he was about to leave, he wanted to bless the tree as a gratitude. So this is what he said, Ilan, Ilan, tree, tree, what should I bless you with? If I will say that you should have good shade, you already have. If I will say that you should have always a source of water, that you should never die, you already have. If I will say that you should have good, sweet, big fruits, you already have. If I will bless you that you should stand in a place that it's great for you, you already have a good location. So what should I bless you with? That everything that will be planted from you will have the same blessing that you have. That's a mashal. That's a parable. That's what Hashem said to Avraham. I will bless your children just to be like you. You're a blessed person. You're righteous. You're the first one who looked for me. You're the first one that discovered me. You're willing to die for me. You fought all the wicked people and showed them the truth. No one can be greater than you. What should be my blessing to you? You already have everything. So my blessing for you should be that your children should be like you. Should be like you. Some big rabbis had great sons like them, like the Stipler, the greatest holy man in the world at that time. And his son is the greatest holy man in the world right after him. Didn't have many kids, but the one he had was the light of the world. Rav Ovadia, a few banim, that they're all big Talmidei Chachamim, and many other rabbis. Some of their children became very big Chachamim, but other rabbis, their children became nothing. Business people, askanim. You know what askanim means? Political activist. He has an organization, this one this, this one is in banking, this one giving loans, this one runs a gemach. Everyone found what to do to make themselves a salary. Not everyone became a big Chacham. Just because the father sits and learns and puts his life into the Torah, unfortunately, in this generation, it's not enough to make the children just as good. Why? Because they have the world. They have the streets. They have friends. They go out there. What they see the father does in the house, make an impact. But then they go on the street and they see all kinds of fake people. And they see so many wicked, secular, naked people. And they see so many hypocrites out there. And they see so many fake, modern, religious modaks that they are closer to be goyim than to be religious Jews. And all of this impact of society brings them down. Especially the greed. Especially the greed. Why? The father is very deep into the Torah. The last thing he's worried about is about money. He doesn't care. Give him a simple suit to wear. He will wear it 20 years. He doesn't care about vacations and trips and the best meat and this, nothing. Some of them don't go to a restaurant ever. So they don't care about this world. They are full with happiness from the Torah. The children, they go to school, they see rich kids. They get jealous. He has credit card, he buys himself whatever he wants, he buys drinks. I cannot afford anything. So what happened? The Satan comes to the kid and says, with all due respect to your father,
he sits and learns Torah all day. You want to be like that? You also going to live such simple life? Look at all your friends. Look at the clothes they buy. Look at the car they get when they become 17. And the Yetzer Hara says, I want to be rich. Usually, when you want to be rich, nothing will come out of you when it comes to Torah. If you want to be a Talmid Chacham, there are two options. You be a poor Talmid Chacham or a rich Talmid Chacham. That's up to Hashem. Some people who gave their life for the Torah, they also made a lot of money from it. Became very rich. People gave them and gave them and gave them and everything they want, they have. Or they marry a daughter of some billionaire and he took care of everything. Or they became very important Chachamim, head of the Beit Din and stuff like that. And they make money. You can make money. If you are a real Talmid Chacham that the community needs you, you can make a lot of money. You can make chupot. You can make britot. You can make bar mitzvah. You can do a lot of things. You can make a nice parnasa. The problem is that parnasa comes from Hashem. It doesn't come from the efforts or the Shlomo HaMelech say, lo lachachamim chokhmah. Lo lachachamim lechem. The Chachamim, the wise scholars of Torah, has no guarantee that the wisdom in Torah will bring them parnasa. And we have many stories in the Gemara of the biggest, holiest people in the world that barely had money to even eat a piece of bread a day. One slice of bread a day, some of them didn't have. One of them was Rabbi Avraham Ibn Ezra, one of the important commentaries on the Torah 750 years ago. Was extremely poor, extremely poor. He had days I didn't eat for days. That's how poor he was. Legend, biggest chacham, and very, very poor. Why he was poor? He refused to go to the rich people and ask them for money. He would get any amount of money if he wants. If a big chacham would come to him and say, I need help personally. I ran into debt. I have bills to pay and I don't have money. Can you help me out? In 1 minute, you'll call all your rich friends and arrange for him $10,000, $20,000 to get him out of his mess, if you are a decent human being. Ibn Ezra didn't want to do it. He wants to be poor. If Hashem wants, he'll give me. If not, I don't want from anyone anything. And we have Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa in the Gemara. The Gemara says that the whole world eats thanks to his righteousness. He made the path to Hashem to bring wealth to the world. And he eats carobs all week. Carobs. Carobs is like pieces of wood. It cuts the stomach. It kills you. It has a little bit sweetness in them. But the last thing you want is to eat carobs all day. Imagine what it does to the stomach. The whole world is eating thanks to him. And he is the most poor guy you can find. So we had a lot of cases like this. In the Gemara. So the question is, how can it be? Don't be surprised. Shlomo HaMelech already said, Lo lachachamim lechem. Wisdom does not bring lechem, meaning bread to the table. You need to daven to Hashem, you need to pray to Hashem, and you need Hashem to agree to give it to you. We continue from here. Avraham was a peaceful man. He didn't want to get into a fight with Lot. So he said to Lot, choose whatever you want. Choose any side you want. Lot, of course, chose the green side. He left Avraham in a brown side, in the desert. The green means there's a lot of food for the sheep. Avraham gave Lot everything he had. And he said, Avraham said, why should we have an argument? Here, take whatever you want. I'll make you wealthy. Choose a side you want to go and go. And he chose the good side. Where did he go? Where did he go after he left his righteous uncle? What was his destination? He moved from Jerusalem to Tel Aviv. Yeah. Or in America, he moved from Muncie to San Francisco. And when he arrived over there, all the wicked people... When he arrived over there, all the wicked people were very, very happy that a religious man the nephew of the most important person in the world, Abraham, how do we know that the Ephron told Abraham, Nasi Elohim ata betochenu, you are the representative of God among us. You are the holiest man. So now his nephew, come to join the wicked people in San Francisco. What did they do? Immediately gave him a job. What was his job? He joined the Supreme Court of Sodom. No joke. He became a judge. Rashi writes, Oto yom minu oto leshofet. So he's sitting in the most corrupted court in the history of the world. On purpose, the laws of Sodom is everything against Hashem. Just like today in Tel Aviv. Just like today in Manhattan. Just like today in many other places in the world, unfortunately. Declaration of war against Hashem. Sometimes they don't care. This law, that law, both of them are good for them. But when they find that one of them comply with the Torah and the other doesn't, immediately they will choose the negative one. What do you care? This doesn't bother you. You agree with that? No. But that's a religious law. We resist it. Why? On purpose to go against Hashem. That's where Lot went to. So, Rabotai, Lot, you know what happened with him. Two daughters he had left. From them, two nations came, Ammon and Moab. Lot did not leave anything important in the world. However, one good thing will come out of him is the Mashiach. The Mashiach eventually comes from Lot. If you know the story of Judah and Tamar, I once explained the whole concept there. Why Lot Zachal Shemashiach will come from him? If he became from righteous to wicked, he deserves a reward? He doesn't deserve anything. He already got wealth in this world, Meshalem LaRasha El Panav LaAvido, and that's it. Why does he have the merit that Mashiach eventually will come out of him? For 1 second that he was quiet, 1 second in his life, he got that gift. When Avraham came to Paro, and Paro asked, who is this beautiful woman? Sarah is the prettiest woman in the world. Avraham said, she's my sister. And Lot was standing over there. And he was dying to correct Avraham. But if he will correct Avraham, the king will know that Avraham lied to him. Anyone who stands in front of the king and lies to him, it's a death penalty. So Avraham will get killed and Lot will become a billionaire. Now he's wealthy, but now he's going to become extremely wealthy because all the wealth of Avraham will go to him. Avraham has no sons. That was the chance of his life, to win the lottery. All you had to do is to sell your uncle and you become the richest man in the world. And he, the Torah told us that he was the greediest person. That's the only reason he joined Avraham in his journey. To protect his asset, his inheritance, his future inheritance. Otherwise, why will he want to follow Avraham? He can live in his place. He follow him to make sure the day he die, everything will be mine right there. And that second, he was quiet. And for that, the Mashiach is going to come out of him. Can you believe this? That's why the Chachamim say, sometimes to be quiet is much harder than to talk. Not to talk is much harder than to talk. When you have something to say and you have to be quiet, like you have Lashon Hara, a juicy one, to tell everyone that speak about someone, but they don't know about this detail. And you say, wow, if I throw this bomb now, I'll become the hero of the gang. Then I gave them that juicy piece of news. And you say, no, but it's Lashon Hara, I can't, it's against the Torah. By the way, I want to ask you a question. What happened if for 5 minutes, as they speak bad about that person, you were holding yourself for 5 minutes not to share the news with them? And in the end, you broke. After 5 minutes, you did say the Lashon Hara. But for 5 minutes, you were fighting your evil inclination. So the question now, there's no question that you're going to be punished for the Lashon Hara. That's obvious. The question is, are you also going to be rewarded for the 5 minutes you survived fighting your yetzer hara not to tell lashon hara, or since in the end you told the lashon hara, the 5 minutes efforts go down the drain with it. Will Hashem pay you for that 5 minutes that you resist yourself? Yeah. Or since you in the end fail, you fail. Huh? What do you think, Avram? No reward? No? What do you say? How many? What? No reward? Avram is my student 25 years. He knows what to say. But if he wouldn't know, that's a shame for me. You get a reward for the 5 minutes, the stipler say, that you get the reward for the effort, just like he said. So even an effort that in the end failed, you get a reward for the effort. Look how wonderful Hashem is. If you have an effort for your boss and in the end you didn't bring the client, you made 50 phone calls to try to hunt the customer, and in the end he left, he didn't sign. Your boss is going to pay you half of the deal, half of the commission? No. You didn't bring anything, no commission. Once in a while you have a decent boss, he wants to give a push to his employee, he sees that he's trying, he gives him some bonus or upfront commission. Here, take some money upfront. Why? He wants to encourage him not to break. It happens, but with Hashem is regardless. Whatever efforts you made to do the right thing, even if later you fail and you did the wrong thing, you're going to be punished for the wrong thing, but you're going to be rewarded for the effort, which is amazing. So anyway, Rabotai, Moshe comes to Hashem now in the beginning of Parashat Dvarim, and he said to the nation, I cannot carry you and be your babysitter on my own anymore. It's an impossible mission. Rashi writes, the nation of Israel are fighting with each other. Lots of disagreement, lots of machlokot. Everyone has to express his opinion. Who told you we care about your opinion? I don't care if you care or not. I still have to express myself. That's why everyone has today a page. Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, everyone became a reporter. Every little beep in his life, everybody has to know. I bought shoes. Wow. Kapai, we bought shoes. Very nice. People are living in an imaginary world. The problem is that their stupidity has customers. Stupidity as customer. Just like in Israel, when I was a child, I went to a store that sell all kinds of altizachen, and I saw sardine boxes with the Israeli flag on it. I asked the guy, what's these boxes? You know, you open it like this, like you open a tuna can or sardine can. He told me, that's for you, that's for the tourists. I said, what do you mean for the tourists? He said, the tourists are dumb. They come here, they hear the Holy Land, we sell them hair from the Holy Land, hair. So that they should take it with them to New York. No, and what's going to happen? They open the can, and the hair from the Holy Land will be in Long Island somewhere, or in a village. Huh? You get the point? And people were paying a few dollars for those cans. So if you have dumb people in the world, you can sell anything. One of the best proofs is diamonds. Well, it's logically, it's the dumbest thing on earth. You pay $100,000 for a piece of glass that shines, when they can make the same exact cubic zirconia for $10 or $20 and looks exactly the same, and even professionals, when look at the finger of the woman, they cannot tell. If they take it to a lab, they will find out. But right now, from the outside, it looks like a 10 carat, it's $20, and it's instead of $10 million or $5 million or whatever it was. So why people would burn so much money on it? If he's a drug dealer and he wants to smuggle money from country to country, it's an easy way to take diamonds in a pocket. But anyone else, why would he need diamonds for? The answer, one dumb person decided to get it, and everyone copy for hundreds of years. I don't know if you're aware, do you know how difficult it is to get those diamonds? If you see what a hole they dig in the ground, it's more than 100 yards deep. And the truck goes in circles. It takes years to dig until you go to the mines, all the way to the bottom. It's incredible work. Today, by the way, they do it in the lab. It's better quality, without effort. The lab does it. Lab, it's a quarter of a price. Looks better, better quality, quarter of a price. Why? No effort. You pay for the effort. I have a picture of a diamond mine. I see how the trucks drive, and it keeps going lower and lower and lower. You have to see how deep it is. You can put inside the hole a building of maybe 30, 40 floors. That's how deep it is. Why people have to kill themselves so much to get a piece of glass that will shine? The answer, pure stupidity. I remember one time I went to 47th Street. My friend took me to an office there. I saw some pink rubies on a table. Look like pink marble. You know the marble that you have in the kitchen? Pink color. I look at the big stone and a lot of small stones. I have a little sticker on it. What is it? $2.2 million. That little ruby. And every one of the little stone, 110,000 each. It's a set, $4.4 million sold already. Laying there on a table. Between me and you, that's not pure stupidity? Something like this, 4.4 million? Especially when you know, if you take the 4.4 million, you can put 1 million Jewish kids in yeshiva instead of public school. Move them to yeshiva. 500,000, 100,000, 20,000, any amount is already a great bargain. What's better, to have a $4.4 million ring or to take thousands of kids and move them into a kosher school? They become servants of Hashem. So, stupidity, it's everywhere. What can we do? So, Rabotai, Moshe say to them, I cannot be your babysitter anymore. Moshe comes to Hashem and say, Echa! Echa! Where is the promise you promised to Abraham? Eiko, Echa. You promised Abraham that his children will be blessed. They will be special. They will behave like Abraham. Look at them, how much they fight. Fighting. Tov. Then years later comes the prophet Yeshaya. And he asks, he sees that the first temple is getting destroyed for three horrible sins. And then he asks, how did you allow such a thing to happen to your temple? Where is the promise you gave Abraham? Eiko, Echa, Eiko. Where is the Ko? Where is the Moriah mountain? Where is the blessing of Abraham Avinu? The nation took it over. Now I want to ask you, the hatred that you have now in Israel between the right wing and the left wing, the right wing include in it the religious people, the modern Orthodox, the Datim Leumim, and secular righties, people that have right ideology but are not religious or partially religious. The question that we have right now, the hatred, is it sinat chinam or no? Everywhere you go today, everybody speaks about the sinat chinam. How can you build a temple? Look at the sinat chinam. Look what's happening on the streets of Israel. Is this baseless hatred or no? I think, my personal opinion, that the hate over there is completely have a base. It's not baseless. There is a reason why there is so much hate. The wicked people hate the righteous side. Why? They don't want to be religious. They're afraid that if the righties will take over, they're going to start changing laws. They won't be able to be gays. They won't be able to be mechalelei Shabbat on the streets. They will have to hide in a house. They won't be able to do all kinds of things that the Torah does not permit. So they are already looking into the future, and they are worried because they want to stay wicked. So the hate that they have to the religious people and to the rabbis and to the righties, is this a baseless hatred or a hate that has a reason? 100% has a reason. The reason could be not justified, but it's still a reason. The righteous people that hate the wicked, they hate the way they behave, they hate what they do, they hate their abomination parades, they hate that the Mechalelei Shabbat all over Israel, they hate the way they dress on the street or forget to dress on the street. So when they are allergic to them and don't want anything to do with them, and they don't want to bring them into their homes, this hatred is baseless or it has a serious base? So what are the people comparing it to Tisha B'Av? In Tisha B'Av, there was sinat chinam, baseless hatred. Meaning the sinah was not possible to justify it. But today, I can give you a million reasons to justify the hate. A million reasons. One reason is what the Gemara say, that the ignorant Amei Arotzot hate Talmidei Chachamim. That's a rule that Hashem made in the world. The more righteous and high scholar you are in Torah, the more they hate you. And the Gemara says something interesting. They hate you very much, but their wife always will hate you more. Let's try to understand that. I understand Reuven hates Shimon because Shimon is a big rabbi and is full of knowledge. And this guy Reuven is a total fool. Only nonsense come out of his mouth. So everyone ran to kiss the hand of Shimon and ask brachot for him and give him all kinds of tzedakah when nobody looks at this fool. So he's full of rage. Look how my cousin gets all the attention and nobody looks at me. Everyone wants to sit in his table in a Shabbaton. Now one person wants to sit with me. So it makes him hate the righteous person. But why the wife more? Why the wife more? Who can give me a reason? The answer is, nothing makes the wife happier in life when people respect her husband. Even if she hates him. I made a whole clip about it, which went viral in Israel. Everyone watched it. I asked, how do you make peace between a husband and wife that are secular in Israel, that wants to kill each other, hate each other, allergic to each other, they beat up each other, they curse each other, and are about to get divorced any day. They already serve paper to each other. How do you make peace between them in 1 minute? The answer is, you invite them to a religious wedding. Separate men, separate women. But you don't tell them. When they arrive to the catering hall, there is a guard over there. Shalom, Erev Tov. Sir, please go to the right. Ma'am, go to the left. What do you mean? It's a religious wedding. Your husband will be with the men and you'll be with all the women. Ma? What? I won't sit with my husband? What is this? You controlling me? I want to sit with my husband at the same table. Ma'am, it's a religious wedding. The women, there's a mechitza. You have to be here and he has to be on the other side of the mechitza. No! You should have told us. Moshe, let's go home. What do we need this wedding for? What do you mean? It's my brother. The heck with your brother. I'm not sitting without you.
Yeah, you're right. Listen, buddy, can I give you 50 bucks? You put at the table for me and my wife together. Wow, zug yonim. Look how they fell in love with each other.
One second. Why? Tell you why. They hate each other very much. But they hate the religion more than what they hate each other. Because when they hate the religion, it's with the help of the Satan, the Yetzer Hara. And their hate to the religion will always overcome just hate to someone for personal reasons. I give you a proof from life. Saudi Arabia hate Israel very much. If they could wipe out Israel by pressing a button, believe me, they will do it a long time ago. For over 1,000 years, they would love to do it. But right now, they became very friendly with Israel. Cooperate together. Why? They are shaking from Iran. Their hate to Iran is so big that they fell in love with each other for the time being. Why? There is something we hate more. I give you another example. You have a person that loves money very much, but he loves to lay down also all the time. He's very lazy. All day he wants to lay down. You finally give him a job, instead of dancing that he finally got some parnasa, he thinks, oh no, I have to go now, waste 2-3 hours and make some money. They take me out of my bed. Wow, I have to wake up at 10 in the morning. Oh my God, what a nightmare. All day he wants to lay down. So the question now, how do you know if the person will come to the job or not? Depend what he has more. More laziness or more love for money? Because two powers collide with each other now. The love for money requires effort. The love to sleep all day is the opposite. But one will kill the other. If the laziness will overcome the greed, he won't come to the job. If the greed overcome the laziness, he will force himself out of bed to come and make money. So the fact that some people kill themselves making money in 2-3 jobs, working in a weekend, getting up 6 in the morning to be in the office early, never it's a sign of hard working. They could still be very much lazy. The reason they are very motivated, because although they hate to work so much, although they hate effort so much, they love money so much, the love for the money overcome their laziness. If you ask them to help in something that will not bring them money, there is no chance they will ever come out of bed. If you're still not convinced, I had once a guy, I told him, why you don't come to shul in the morning? Shachrit. 7 o'clock odu. 7 o'clock odu. Come to the yeshiva to daven with us. Kvod Harav, don't exaggerate. I'm already davening at home. I keep Shabbat. I eat kosher. I go with kippah and tzitzit. You want to kill me like this? I can't wake up 6:30 in the morning to be in yeshiva 6:45. I can't. I go to sleep late. I'm on my computer, 2, 3, I'm by the time I fall asleep. You expect me to wake up after 3 hours? All day I'll be sleepy. No matter how many times you hinted to him that it's time to wake up and start the day correctly, the laziness overcome his righteousness. Laziness is here, righteousness is here. You know what will be the outcome. One time I had a great idea. I came to him, I said, listen, I found you a sponsor, very rich man. I told him how great you're doing and you need that last push. So he's willing to give you an unbelievable offer. Every morning you will be in the yeshiva before 7 a.m., 1 minute before, as long as it's not after. He will pay you $1,000 cash that day for 3 months. Until you get used to it, it will be a part of your life, he will cut the budget. You can make $90,000 here.
He looks at me and says, "Ah, you're making fun at me, Rabbi? Kvod HaRav, אתה עושה צחוק ממני, מה?" Like they say in Israel, אתה מסתלבט עליי? I say, "No, no, חס וחלילה, מה? נערת אולי." Every morning you come, I wait by the door. As soon as you walk in, you have an envelope with $1,000 cash. Guarantee. Try me. If tomorrow you show up and I don't give you the envelope, don't come ever again. What do you want? Don't talk to me anymore. No, come on, stop with this nonsense. You don't trust me? I'm going to make myself, make a fool out of myself. Tomorrow morning you come in and you have $1,000. The next day, every day $1,000.
He said, "You're not joking?" I said, "No, I'm very serious."
"Okay, deal."
I went like this. "Get out of here, you loser. You liar."
"What? You're making fun at me? I ask you if it's real." He got angry.
I said, "I just wanted to prove to you that everything comes out of your mouth is a lie. Just 5 minutes ago, you told me, 'I can't. You killed me. I can't. I can't. There's no way I can.' As soon as I offer you a few $100 bills, you became a tiger. Deal.
You know what? You would be tomorrow at 6 o'clock over there to make sure not to waste the, to lose the opportunity. You put 5 alarms. Even if you're going to sleep at 6:15, you'll be up.
So next time when you say 'I can't,' change the words to 'I do not want enough.' I want to come to Shachrit, I want to come to Shul, but I do not want it enough to actually do it. It requires effort. And I'm a lazy bum, and my laziness overcome my desire to daven with minyan, and therefore, he stays home. Makes sense or no? By the way, it's to everything in life. If a person has a lot of greed, why he doesn't become Shomer Shabbat? He doesn't want to close the store. In his mind, the money that he makes on Shabbat will stay by him. He doesn't know it's going to go to horrible causes. None of that money will be left by him. He doesn't know. He works for nothing. But in his mind, the best day on in a business is Shabbat. How many people don't keep Shabbat just because of their desire to cigarette? So one desire overcome the other desire. They have a desire to be Shomer Shabbat. They would love to be Shomer Shabbat. They cry that they're not Shomer Shabbat. But they don't want to let go to this desire of cigarette. And I can give you thousands of examples like this. Same thing Lashon Hara. Well, a person that speaks Lashon Hara, he doesn't know it's forbidden. He even knows that he will be punished for it. While he speaks Lashon Hara, he already knows Hashem is probably so angry at me. And why is he speaking? To relax his Yetzer Hara. It keeps pushing him. Say something. Tov, Rabotai. Moshe says, "Lo takiru panim b'mishpat, kakaton kagadol tishmaun." Do not be not fair as a judge in a trial. You have to be objective. You can't pick up side. You cannot turn the judgment to the opposite side. Judges have to look at a simple person and a great person like they are equal in the court. Whether it's the biggest rabbi on earth right now and the dumbest person in the country are fighting over money, or whatever the case may be, landlord tenants, or two partners, or neighbors, whatever the case may be, you have to forget that one of them is a loser and the other one is a winner. You have to forget it. You look at two people that like the first time you see them in your life. If automatically you give more respect to one side than the other, you already break the laws of the Torah. Rashi gives a perfect explanation for it. Sheye chaviv alecha din shel pruta ke din shel mea mane. First of all, it doesn't matter how much is the delegation is about. $100 or $1,000,000. Respect the case 100% equally. Why? In Judaism, it's not the quantity. It's the truth. The truth is above everything.
whether it's $100 case, whether it's $1 billion case. We are searching now for the truth. So we are not impressed by how much money here or who are the people in the courtroom. That's not relevant. Here in America, it's a different story. Sleepy Joe and his son, there is not one violation they didn't do. But everyone protects them. The FBI, this, protects them. Why? God forbid if they'll get indicted, what's going to happen? Trump is going to come back. We want to control America. For that, we'll twist the judgment. One Israeli general have a lot of information about his son, Hunter. You know what they did? He went to Turkey. They arrested him there. They want to judge him here in the United States, claiming he sold weapon, all kinds of things. He said, the only reason they do it to me because I have information about his son, which will burn America if it will come out. So now he's stuck somewhere, and they are fighting to bring him here to America. What do you think is going to happen to him when he comes here? Use your imagination. So that's what's going on here. If it's someone the lefties love, immediately they take his side regardless of the truth. If it's a religious person come to court, immediately they'll do everything they can to convict him. Everything they can. Why? The last thing they care about is the truth. The court is a mafia. In mafia, they go with the one they love and they go against the one they hate, regardless of who is right.
You remember once I told the story many years ago, unbelievable story. There was one Hasidic man that had a handicapped boy. And the boy, it was very hard for the boy to take the bus with his wheelchair. Man, it was the old days, 30 years ago. Where are you going to put the wheelchair? People have to bring it up to the bus. He decided he has to buy a car. But he's an avrech in yeshiva. He took some loans, some help. He had $7,000 and he came to a place, used car salesman. There's a yard that sells cars. He said to the guy, there are three partners over there, not religious. I need a good car with a big trunk that I'll be able to put the wheelchair of my son in the trunk and drive him to yeshiva every day and pick him up. So one of the partners was a big crook. He said to him, here, you have this Dodge Dart. He has a very big trunk. It's a very solid car. And you have this Volvo, and you have this, and you have that. But that's the best one. You should take that. Which one? The Volvo. The Volvo. The poor guy, he takes out the money. How much it is? $7,000. It's a little more, but we'll give you a discount. The Hasid begins to count the money. While he's doing it, one of the partners saw that he has a son. He had mercy on him. He knew this Volvo, the engine is finished. They put inside all kinds of thick oil that the engine would run another week or two. In 2 weeks, the engine will burn, and this poor guy will be stuck with his son in the wheelchair. He felt bad about it. So he said to him, I don't understand. Why do you want the Volvo? There are other cars here. Come, don't rush. Look, we have other cars here. The other partners look at him. Why you'd confuse him? He likes the Volvo. We gave him a special price. Don't drive him crazy. Don't pay attention to him. Okay, keep counting. When he saw that the Hasid doesn't get the hint, he was very naive, this guy. Some people are so honest in their life, they can't even imagine that someone will do such thing to them. They never experience something like it. They never think to do something like this to anyone. In their environment, everyone is very honest. So when they finally come to a place of such a crook, is he going to eat them alive? Eat them alive. So when he saw he's not getting the point, he's about to put the money on the table as he's counting it, he said to him, the Volvo is a finished car. Don't touch it. The engine is about to die any day. Trust me, you don't want it. Wow, the Hasid saw it, took the money, went quickly with a wheelchair and ran away. The partners, boom, boom, a fist fight, breaking a table on his head. Don't dare to show your face over here. We'll kill you if you come again. You traitor. He went home. He told his wife what happened. Remember, two secular people. The wife said to him, whatever happened, happened. I'm so proud of you. I would love my husband to be a human being and not some monster who take advantage on a kid on a wheelchair. I'm with you. Whatever happened, happened. So they call a borer. You know what a borer? Borer means a mediator. To rule what to do in a partnership. Who is the mediator? The head of the mafia. A gangster, a killer. A drug dealer. Loan shark. Breaking people's leg that they don't pay. This kind of people. He sits now. They tell the story. He said to the gangster, how could I let the little boy get stuck now in a car with a wheelchair on a highway? Don't you have a heart? Very nice. You decided all of a sudden to be tzaddik, the gangster say. Good for you. But the car was $7,000. $2,000 of it was yours. You have to pay them $5,000. Half to him, half to him. And you cannot step in a business. You're not loyal to your partners. You lost your share in a business. There's nothing you can do because if you go against the ruling of the gangster, they'll kill you. Mafia. So he went home. Now he's unemployed. So his wife said, listen, you used to be a mechanic. Look for a job. Maybe someone will hire you. Start looking in the newspapers. What happened? He found a job. Bus mechanic for a private bus company, religious company in Yerushalayim. They have a bus for religious people, buses. He comes to the place, he sees maybe 40 people waiting online to get interviewed by the board. And he said to himself, 10 years I was not a mechanic. I don't even remember half of what I have to do. Look at all these mechanics over here. They're all younger, they're probably much more experienced than me. What chance do I have? But I'm so desperate to find a job. Let me wait. He comes in front of the board. They ask him question. They say to him, listen, we have to be honest with you. At least 20 people from the people we interview are more fit for the job. We're looking for someone to be in charge of all the mechanics here in a garage. We have buses who needs to be fixed. Someone responsible that knows how to run the jobs. But we will be in touch. As he's leaving, thinking, why I wasted 3 hours waiting here, he eats his heart. He's by now 9 months unemployed. Can't find a job. A little Hasidish boy runs after him. Excuse me, excuse me. Can you come back to the room? Ma? They want to talk to you again. I wasted already 3 hours on them. Now I have to go back again. But you know, he got curious. Why would they call me again? He goes back with the boy. He gets in a room. There are 12 members, Hasidim, in a room. They run the company, board. One of them asked them, tell me, did you own a used car garage over there in that street? He said to him, yes. He said, 9 months ago you were still there, right? He said, yes. He said, he took off his hat. Do you recognize me? You look familiar. I came to you to buy a car for my paralyzed boy. And you saved me from buying that Volvo. He said to him, it's you. You are the reason I'm here today. They threw me out of the business. They took away everything. He said to him, can you wait for us a few minutes outside? The Hasid told them, that's the guy we want. That's the one we want. He could not let them cheat me. We want someone like that. He got the job and became the supervisor of all the mechanics. And in the end, he made good money. Maybe less, maybe more. I don't know. But in the end, nobody ever lose from listening to Hashem, from doing the right thing. There used to be a rabbi in Israel, Alav Shalom Zatzal, Rav Moshe Fish. You heard about him? Rav Moshe Fish. Don't forget this name ever. Rav Moshe Fish, Avram, you have two more minutes. Listen to that story. Rav Moshe Fish had a yeshiva in Israel for Argentinian Jewish boys. They come from Buenos Aires. They spend 1 year in Israel. They go back to Buenos Aires to university and continue with their life. So everyone there is Spanish speakers. One boy was the son of the president of the community. After 1 year in yeshiva, he was supposed to go back to university, but he loved the Torah so much, he decided to stay one more year. His father is calling him up. It's it. You come back. He said to him, no, no, I enjoy. I'm in the middle. I want to stay here another year. No, it's going to ruin all the plan. You already registered to the semester. You have to come back. I'm ordering you a ticket. Dad, I'm sorry. Don't pressure me. I want to stay in yeshiva. I'm not so anxious not to go to university. He called up the rabbi, Rav Moshe, make sure my son comes back home. I want him to go to university. He said, how do you expect me to send him out to tell him to leave the Torah? I can't take something like this on myself. He said, listen, you are coming here. We raise all the money for you, for your yeshiva here. I help you many times. I send you to the right people to get money for the yeshiva. If you do not send him back tomorrow, you can forget about coming here to collect money for the yeshiva. Good luck on your own. Rav Moshe said to him, whatever the money situation will be, it's not in my hand and it's not in your hand. It's in Hashem's hand. There is definitely no way I'm going against the Torah to make money. So I cannot tell your son to close the Gemara and go to Argentina when he sits here in Yerushalayim. If he decides, that's his free will. The father arrived. He's the president. Everyone has to bow down to me. Pack your stuff and we go now. I'm not coming. Andale, vamos. No. Papa, go back to Argentina. He said to Rafish, you're done. That's it. Now, all the boys that were in yeshiva, slowly, slowly, they get married. So they invite the Rosh Yeshiva to the wedding. So he comes to Argentina to a wedding. They make Sheva Brachot in a chupa. Nobody say hello to him. He sits there. Nobody shakes his hand. People stop giving him money. He's on a ban. They don't give him one bracha. They give all kinds of fools who don't know how to read even. Every word they read is a mistake in a chupa. And they say, they ignore him. So one guy came to him. Said, Rabbi, it breaks my heart to see what they do to you. Why are you a masochist? Why you came here? Why do you need to come here if they treat you like this? It's disrespect for the Torah. He said, how can I not come? This is my children. I taught them in yeshiva. They invite me for the wedding. I'm not going to come. Would you think I come for the bracha in a chupa? No, no, you should not do that. People see it and it breaks their heart. One day Rav Moshe Fish passed and his son said, every big Talmid Chacham, when you ask him what you should do, they will always tell you something that is true. Nobody can ever lose from doing the right thing in the Torah. No one can ever lose. For not stealing, you cannot lose. For giving tzedakah, you cannot lose. From not speaking Lashon Hara, you cannot lose. From not tricking the customer, you cannot lose. You can never lose from fighting your Yetzer Hara and winning. You cannot lose. There's no such thing to lose. You want to put mezuzot, you buy the best one. You pay more, but you cannot lose. Hashem is going to send you back the money. Same thing, tefillin, same thing, everything. But my father had a different approach. My father said, Hashem, whatever I do and sacrifice for you, I'm begging you, please do not make it up to me. Don't pay me back.
Don't give me back the money I sacrificed. Don't do anything for me. If I had to lose $10,000 for not breaking the laws of the Torah, do not send me that $10,000 from a back door. I am honored to lose for the sake of the truth. I wanted to be costful. You understand? That's a whole different league. That's a whole different league. I gave it to a boy, 16 years old. I told him, read. You had to see how the Yetzer Hara was fighting that he won't read that story. Oh, I'm tired. Lay there. So only 1 minute. Read. I already knew that this story is going to change his life. In the end, I forced him to read. I saw in his body language. He was shocked. So, wow. Wow. One word. Wow. Everyone say, well, why are you doing it? Why should I lose? I cannot lose. I just helped someone. Hashem is happy. Hashem is going to stick a knife in my back for doing the right thing, for not lying, for not stealing. How can it be? But Rav Moshe Fee say, I don't want it back. I just sacrifice X amount of donors. Don't give them back to me from somewhere else. Whatever I lose, I lose. That was an unbelievable thing. So, Rabotai, before we finish, we have 15 more minutes. Rav Israel Salant, he said that you're not allowed to judge two people in your courtroom and turn the truth of the judgment to one of the sides, meaning, let me explain. The same way, if two people stand in your courtroom, you're not allowed to choose one of them and have a favorite. You don't like her because she's a pretty woman. You don't like him because he's a rich man. You don't like him because he's more religious than him. Right now, in a courtroom, you have to pay attention to the details of the case. Maybe the secular guy is right. The religious one is not right. He has to pay not the secular guy. You have to rule the truth. Maybe the goy is right, and the religious Jew has to pay the goy. You have to take the side of the goy, based on the evidence. Rav Israel Misalan say, the same thing with within yourself. Within yourself, you have two powers that are acting on you every day. The good inclination and the evil inclination. You have to be a judge on yourself. The Yetzer HaTov and the Yetzer HaRa, they try to pull you to their direction. Every one of them make his claim. The Yetzer HaRa will say, well, you're going to go all the way now to the lecture. It's going to be 20 minutes. It's going to cost you $20 gas. And until you find parking, and the lecture is more than 2 hours, you can watch it little by little on YouTube. What's the rush? You save the $20, you save the parking area. That's the Yetzer HaRa. Comes the Yetzer HaTov and say, no, but one lecture when you physically come, it's equal to more than 1,000 that you watch online. Because when you come to the lecture, you are a partner of creating the lecture. That means everyone watch it later, you get a share in it. Because if you wouldn't come, there wouldn't be a lecture. The only reason there is a lecture is because you bothered and you came. So now you become like the speaker. He makes the profit and you make the profit. And those who sponsor the lecture, sometimes they are sick people or people that need shidduch, people that need Yeshua, they sponsor the lecture. All these names that we read, they sponsor. So when they sponsor the lecture, thanks to them, there is now a lecture that will be viewed by tens of thousands of people. So there, it's not just one lecture of 2 hours for them. It's 300,000 hours. It's 600,000 hours, depending on how many people watched it. So that's the Yetzer HaTov. And the Yetzer HaRa, of course, is going to make the claim. And you have to be a fair judge between them. What does it mean, a fair judge? You know that the good inclination is right. But you love the bed. You want to lay down now. Oh, to get dressed now, snowing outside, to get the snow out of the car, to drive to Bet Eliyahu Shul, Fresh Meadow,
and to come late at night, freezing, windy. Ah, the bed is so warm. Hashem understands me, I'm sure. Ah, Hashem, I'm not going to miss the lecture. You know, I watched all of them. Even if I don't show up. What happened? It's all baloney. Inside, he knows what's the truth. But he takes bribe from the Yetzer Hara. Same thing when a guy dates a non-Jewish girl, he receives from her bribe. When someone comes and shows him what the Torah says about this forbidden relationship, the bribe that he receives from her daily clogged his judgment. Because the Torah says, "Ki ha-shochad ya'aver enei chachamim v'yisalef divrei tzadikim." So when you like an individual that did a favor to you, or because you like them because of where they came from, or because of their look, or because they give you money, automatically you're not objective. You automatically turn to their favor. Not because you, God forbid, a corrupted judge, that you know the Torah say not to do it, and you go against Hashem. No. If we connect you to a lie detector after the trial, it will show that you ruled the truth according to what you saw. But the Satan, the bribe, twisted your judgment. Because you take favorite, you cannot see the negative in him. You understand what happened? That's why many, many times you warn a person from his future husband or future wife. And because of the bribe they're already receiving in the relationship, they cannot see it. Then they come a few months later to cry to you, "Why didn't I listen to you?" Because once the bribe finished, they are now in a big fight. There's no more feeding each other with bribe. All the truth comes on the screen, crystal clear. And that's the words of the Chazon Ish. Chazon Ish, if a person will be disconnected from the cords of the materialistic life, of the desires of this earth, for 1 hour, 1 hour it will be free from material hunger. From material hunger. Material means clothing, cars, women, jewelry, sports, vacation. That's material. Free for 1 hour, he will see the world in clear eyes. Meaning as long as he is handcuffed by the desires of this world and what the world has to offer, he can never see the divine truth in a clear eyes. That's why so many people have terrible ideology. That's why so many modern people, like I said before, they are more like goyim than religious Jews in their behaving every day. In the way they talk, in the way they dress, in the way they eat, in the way they make bracha. Their Birkat Hamazon is 13 seconds. Get up. And that 13 seconds, he checked already 3 or 4 emails. When they come to Daven Shmona Esrei, I know people like this. No exaggeration. Half a minute, they finish. You come to Baruch Ata Hashem Ha'el HaKadosh, the one in front of you, and sit down. How is it possible? I read Hebrew from birth. You're American. You can never read even half as fast as me. How did you finish in less than 30 seconds? When it takes me minimum 5 minutes, if I rush. 7 minutes with good pace. How did you finish in 30 seconds? There's only one answer. You never davened. Now once in your life, probably. It's a burden for you. You come just to show that you were in shul. That's it. Maybe he's afraid of his wife. What is he going to do? Not going to Minyan on Shabbat morning? He showed up at 10:45 to the Chabad Minyan. Baruch Hashem, we have Chabad in town. Then he sits, he eats some chulent and some cookies and drink. And then he show up to Alenu Leshabeach. I was in a Minyan. Who wrote Alenu Leshabeach? Huh? Yehoshua ben Nun. When did he write it?
When did he write it? Just when they occupied the land and divided the land.
Alenu leshabeach, there are two paragraphs. It starts from Ayin, finish with Dalet. Starts with Ayin, finish with Dalet. Ayin, Dalet, Ed, witness. Two witnesses. Why we read it in the end of the davening, Alenu leshabeach, that whatever we say until now, from the beginning to the end, these two witnesses testify that it's all true. But what was the purpose of this prayer, Alenu leshabeach, that the Goyim had a big complaint against the Jews when they came to the Holy Land, which used to be the land of Canaan, and occupied the land from the seven nations over there. So the Goyim in the world say, what kind of a nation you are? You were in Egypt, you're coming to the land of Canaan, you fight seven nations that's sitting there for decades, you kick them out of their homes, and you occupy the land. That's why in Alenu Leshabeach, it said that Hashem is the master of the universe, master of the world. The Gemara say, the Torah should have started with Achodesh Hazeh Lachem, Achodesh Hazeh Lachem, Chodesh Chodashim, meaning this month, the first mitzvah in the Torah is to sanctify the renewal of the moon and to make Rosh Chodesh. So the Taryag Mitzvot, you start from the first one. Why the Torah starts with the story of Genesis, the creation of the world? Rashi writes that the whole world will know that the master of the world, every piece of land belongs to him. When he wants, he gives it to Mr. X. When he wants, he takes it from Mr. X and gives it to Mr. Y. While you are there, it's never yours. You only have permission to sit there as long as I want. That's why the Torah starts, Bereshit bara Elokim tashamayim v'taharetz. God created heaven and earth, created the whole world, and he is the owner of everything. By the way, we the Jewish people, that Hashem gave us the Holy Land, right? It's written in the Torah that the Goyim admit that it's the book of God. Baruch Hashem, we're lucky. They admit in the mouth, but in their actions, they do the opposite. But in their mouth, in their churches, in their mosque, they read that God gave Israel to the Jews. Later, they want to kill all the Jews and give it to the Palestinian thieves that made themselves a nation all of a sudden, Palestinians. But what about what God say? It's written in your Quran. Who cares about the Quran? We want to kill the Jews. We want them out of Israel. That's it. So what happened? When the Torah was given to us, it's written in the Torah a verse that a lot of Jews don't know. Many of them do not know. What does it say over there? That the deed that we got from God on the Holy Land, we are the only nation that have a formal deed. The Chinese don't have a deed. They are 5,000 years where they are or more, but they cannot present to you any document that the land belongs to them. They are just there for many years. The Arabs, not one country have a deed that Kuwait belongs to them, or Saudi Arabia, or Syria. The Europeans, nobody can present a deed that this place is ours. The only one that has a deed that all religions admit that is a divine deed is the Jews. They have a deed that the Holy Land belongs to them. That's why everyone fight the Jews about the right to be in the Holy Land. No other country, no one challenged the Chinese, what are you doing here? No one challenged the British, the Turkish. Everyone, yeah, it's your country. Who is challenged? The only nation that has a deed. Doesn't make sense? Doesn't make sense? There are three properties that were bought by our fathers, and it's written in a deed. King David bought the Moriah Mountain with full price. It's written in a Tanakh, and the Arabs stole it from us. They made a mosque there. The Me'arat HaMachpelah, the cave of the fathers and mothers in Hebron, Abraham bought it from Ephron Achiti with full price, and they stole it from us. They made a mosque there, and if you come there, they want to kill you. So we are very limited there.
And the Kever Yosef. And also they stole it from us. If you go to Kever Yosef, it's 50% chance to die. They shoot at you. You get bullets at you. You have to go with army, Hamash, and knife risk.
Kever Yosef. It's unbelievable. All the places that were bought by us and belongs to us, and there is a document about it, they stole from us. Now the question that I have is, there is one problem with the deed we have. Who knows? We have to be honest. We're not politicians. We teach the truth, not what's good for us. They teach only what's good for them. We have to teach what God really said. Once Hashem gave us the Holy Land, in the deed there is a warning. You know how sometimes when you buy a car, the leasing company, they put a lien on it, that you owe them such and such? Meaning you can never sell the car until you satisfy the lien. What is the problem we have with our deed? It's called Ilya Vekotzba. Ilya, it's the fatty stomach of the animal. What we call in Israel bees. It's very delicious to those who love fat on a grill. It's pure fat. Fat cubes. They put it on a sich, put it on a grill. It melts in your mouth. You don't even have to bite it. But that area sometimes gets thorns in it. Pieces get stuck because the animal lay on the stomach like this. So they have an expression in Judaism, Ilya Vekotzba. We have the entire fatty, good, delicious piece of the animal, but there's a thorn in it. Meaning there's one problem. You order a huge wall unit, $20,000 piece, mahogany, handmade, with glasses and crystals and lights. And the movers made a scratch, like this in the front. That's called Ilya, something unbelievable, great. But there is something defect in it that ruins the whole thing. Little tiny thing who messes up the whole thing. Like you bought an Armani suit, you pay thousands of dollars, and there's a cigarette hole in it. Somehow in a suit store, someone burned it by mistake. Will you wear it? Big deal, tiny hole. I'm sorry, I have to return it. So when we got the land and we became the owners of the land of God, the Holy Land, there is one warning there. What is it? Ki lo timacher haaretz letzmitut, ki li haaretz. The land is not giving to you as a permanent gift. It's given to you for the time being. As long as I'm interested that you stay there. If you will not follow my Torah and commandments, at any given moment, I may decide to throw you out of the land and give it to other nations. And happen. If I want to throw you out, I will throw you out. If I want to bring you back, I will bring you back. Those are the prophecies that we will come back to the land before Mashiach come. The last thing for today, Rabotai. A judge, two people standing in a room, in a courtroom in front of him. And one is very poor, dressed like a homeless. And the other one is very rich, dressed nice, came with a fancy car. The judge saw him entering the parking of the courtroom, comes with a nice hat, expensive suit. And the guy with the shmate on him, the homeless, he doesn't smell so good. He probably didn't take a shower. For him, the entire year is the 9 days. The judge want to get rid of him, this annoying poor guy. But I have to stand next to him here. So, you know, the Torah say, are you allowed to accept them just like that to the courtroom? One dressed with garbage and one dressed with an expensive suit?
You allowed to allow such a thing or no? No. You ask them, either both of you would dress like homeless, or both of you would dress fancy. It cannot be that one will come fancy and the other one will come homeless. Make sure to dress them equally. Why? Why? Who cares about how they dress? We want to listen to the claim. And what judges the Torah talks about? People in the level of Moshe Rabbeinu. 3,300 years ago, not judges today from the Democratic Party of New York. Not this kind of judges. So, we are wondering, do you really have to go that far? What, are you going to have a suit store in a courtroom that every time people come, you send them first to get dressed? Why is it? You really suspect the rabbi that because one dressed different than the other is going to turn the judgment to a not fair side? The answer is no, we don't suspect the rabbi, no, at all. We know reality. Everything you're looking at affects your subconscious. The best proof for that is all the commercials. How they sell millions of things just by showing you 30-second commercial on TV. All they need is to put a beautiful, pretty woman, smile to you like this, and hold the can in her hand or whatever perfume she sells. That week, they're going to sell 10 times more. Why? It went into the subconscious of the people. Now a woman needs perfume. She comes to the perfume place, duty-free, whatever. Automatically, she's attracted to what's already recorded in the back of her mind, in the subconscious. Sometimes they have hidden commercials in movies, in all kinds of shows. They plant hidden things inside the movie. Like, for instance, when the actors talk, they put something on a table. It's not a part of the movie. But it's already automatically goes into your brain, and now you have already desire for that something. And if we hypnotize you, we'll find out where that desire started. There is a guy in Israel, they call him Aman Achushim. His parents, his genius parents, called him Nimrod. He's not the only Nimrod in Israel. No. So Nimrod is Aman Achushim. One time, you know, on a plane, they have these commercials, El Al commercials. He's the representative. He's the one who show you how to buckle the... You probably saw him if you flew to Israel. So one time, this guy, he stood in the street, and people walk behind him, in the middle of the street. He talks to the camera. He say, after the commercials, we will come back. Before we go to the commercial, I want each one of you to choose a number from 0 to 100. And when we come back from the commercial, I will tell each one of you what number you chose. How can it be? 100,000 people watch him now, they all will choose the same number? Is it possible? I thought to myself, what, he's making a fool out of himself. Let's say he's going to say number 7. 20 people, thousands of people didn't choose 7. It's going to make him a damage. I say, it has to be a trick here. Cannot be this guy is that dumb. Has to be a trick. I chose a number. The second he said, choose a number. I chose a number. He came back, and the number you chose is 23. I almost fainted. That's the number I chose. 23. What? How can it be? He hypnotized me. He put it in my head. What's going on over here? Then he showed the trick. He said, the minute I ask each one of you to choose a number, I made sure that a person will walk behind me with a Michael Jordan t-shirt. Number 23. You didn't pay attention to the people behind me. You were looking at me. But your subconscious record everything all the time. And since I commanded you to choose a number, and you started to think about choosing a number, and that exact second number 23 went into your system, that's the first thing came into your mind.
By the way, this trick, that's how the entire Torah is based on this concept. That's why the Torah says, you're not allowed to look at the face of a wicked person. It makes a huge impact on your soul. You're not allowed to look at the places of idol worshiping, all kinds of churches. You're not allowed to look at them. Looking at them making you a damage. Looking at a not modest person on the street makes you a damage. There's a lot of things that damage the mind. That's why the Torah warned, "Lo tatuach achrei levavchem v'achrei einechem asher atem zonim acharim." What does Hashem care if I look at something? As long as I don't touch it, if I look at drugs and never touch it, I have a problem? I'm curious. I wanted to see what it is. Don't look at it. It creates a crave in the back of your mind. Everything that your parents show you when you were a child will never leave you. It would live with you in the back of your mind, not only in this life, also in your next reincarnation, and the next one, until the end of days. It's already recorded in your neshama. And it affects your behaving. Unbelievable. People that had, they showed them some horrible cartoon when they were young. Do you know how many people in my generation became violent from one cartoon? They love to give punches. Which cartoon ruins the teenager of Israel? Who knows? Popeye. You know Popeye? Most of you are younger. They don't know about Popeye. But 45 years ago, there was a cartoon about Popeye and Olive and Pluto. Pluto was a big fat guy. Popeye was a skinny guy with muscles, but the muscles only when he eats spinach. He has a can. He press on a can, spinach jump, he open his mouth, he goes in, his muscles grow, boom, and he gives this big guy some punches. And there is the wife of Popeye, her name is Olive. She's skinny, like a cane of a broom. And one time she goes with Popeye, one time Pluto steals her. That's the cartoon. They have episodes like this. Every day, different episode. One time he punches him here, one time it's on the boat. Our naive parents, what do they know about this? They think, what's wrong with watching a cartoon? Do you know what this cartoon did? I'll tell you what it did. He took every child in Israel and taught him three few principles in life that are horrible. First, you solve issues with violence. The only way things work is when you begin to punch people. Be strong, give some good punches, you win the battle. People started to eat each other. Same thing they had Bruce Lee movies. Same thing, destroy the mind of the people. And then, one other thing they show, that a wife of a person, it's a toy. One time she's going with her husband, then the big fat guy comes and he's very strong. He grabs her. She goes with him. One day she's with him. One day she's with him. That's how the little secular kids grow up. Don't get me wrong. Today it's a million times worse. Today they show you boy kiss boy. Boy get married to boy. Horrible things. Here in America, by the way, they have a book, totally pornographic, and they teach the kids, young kids, 10 years old, in school, what to do to each other. Here in America, in California. Someone sent me a video, big debate. There's one host that is normal, screaming against this liberal Jew, Wider, senator, I don't know who he is. Some liberal, horrible Jew. Anthony Wider, what's his name? Huh? Yes. No? I'm telling you, some liberal democratic Jew from New York. Wiener. Skinny guy. A Jew. Grew up in Brooklyn. Listen, I wouldn't show this book to my son. But we have no right to tell the school what to do. It's in California. We are here in New York. What kind of a stupid answer is this, you idiot? They are killing children in California and this United States.
It's just a matter of time until they will come here. Once the Satan takes a territory, immediately he moves to the next one. But I'm asking myself, who is this evil monster that put that book into a school that teach 10 years old and show them these pictures over there? It cannot be, believe such thing. I promise you one thing. In many countries in the world, they would hang this person the same day the book came out. Many, many countries. He would be hanged that day. He would not see a day, a light again. Him and his entire family. Here he's probably making millions from that book. And that's the reality, Rabotai. That's the reality. The Torah said to us, "Lo taguru mipnei ish." Do not be afraid from anyone when it comes to the truth. So, what's going on? It's not only for judges. It's for witnesses, for people that needs to rebuke, for people that needs to do what's right, and they embarrass what the people would say. You have to be devoted to the Torah regardless of the opinion of people. They compliment you, they fight you, that's not relevant. First, let's do what's right. And then the rest is not in our hand. But in order for you to be such a person, you have to be like Rav Moshe Fish. That not only I don't expect Hashem to pay me back, and I know that Hashem will always pay me back, I give up on it. Let me sacrifice for the truth. I didn't come here to gain. I came here to do what's right. And if I have to pay for it, I'll pay for it. You know, I wanted to finish with a story. 25 years ago, we had a seminar in New Jersey. There was one Israeli guy who opened a business. Back then, telecommunication was not advanced like today. So he came with some idea of making phones that no one had yet, with voicemail, you know, instead of beepers, special service. It looked like his company is going to make a lot of money. And I set him up with a very rich guy back then to help him in his business. Why did I do that? A few weeks before, we had a seminar in New Jersey, and six Israeli secular guys arrived to the hotel about an hour and a half before Shabbat. They need to get a room. They show up. The girl is sitting there. What's your name? She gives the names. They registered to the seminar. He was their boss. They worked for him in a telephone company. So he sent them to the seminar. So they had to pay. It was $100 and something back there, $150, something like that. It was like $300-$400 today. So the girl said, okay, that's the price. You can be two in a room. This. So, oh, it costs money? We didn't know it cost money. He told us to come to hotel and food and this and lectures. We didn't know if to pay for that. So they're standing over there. So the rabbi said to the girl, call him, see what's going on here. The girl called him up and she said to him, listen, there's six guys here. They have to pay, but they said they didn't know that it costs money. He said, oh, they didn't know. I told them that it costs something. I didn't know how much, but it is what it is. It's embarrassing. So don't worry. I'll pay for everyone. I'll pay you all the money. I was standing there watching this whole thing. A few weeks later, someone that knows him told me about his business. So, oh, that's the guy. He sent us people to the seminar. And then he wanted an investor, and I knew someone. I said, talk to him. In the end, they became partners. The business started picking up. They started to sell in Western Union. The new guy had a connection. In every Western Union, they sold their product. It was a whole big, big difference in the marketing. He doesn't know until today that what happened is only thanks to that moment. That he said, I'll pay for everyone. Why? I send them to a seminar, Shabbat. What? They're going to drive back. By the time they get back to Brooklyn, it's going to be Shabbat already. Immediately he paid for all six of them to come to the seminar, and if I'm not mistaken, some of them came to the yeshiva after that. It's hard to remember 25 years ago. Someone like that, did he lose the money, whatever it was, $900? It was like $2,000 or $3,000 today. Absolutely not. He got it 100 times more a few weeks later. When he comes in front of Hashem one day, will he get a reward for it? That he agreed to pay for the guys? Because Hashem already paid him 10 times more or 100 times more. Will he get a reward? Or Hashem would say, what do you want? I gave you $1 million investor. And that was thanks to that moment. If that moment you say, okay, it's not my problem, they want to pay, send them back home. Many people will do that. And then when the person say he looks for an investment, the last thing I would care about is to find him an investor, right? One thing leads to another. You hear the point here or no? The question is, will he still get a reward or he got paid? Huh? I see you're puzzled. You don't know things like this? So how do you serve Hashem without knowing what you get, what you owed, what's due to you? You don't care. You just do whatever, that's it. But maybe Hashem would say, I paid you in this world. It's all depend if you're righteous or wicked. If you're wicked, whatever Hashem pays you in this world, it's a final payment. Because you don't have a world to come. So he pays you generously over here, and he owes you nothing. But if you're righteous, he will still reimburse you for what you put to do what's right. But the spiritual eternal reward is waiting for eternity. So you make here and there. But the question is, what happened? That's if he gave you exactly what you paid. But what happened if he gave you 1,000 times more the next day, win the lottery? You put a guy or two in yeshiva. The next day, Hashem gave you $200 million in the lottery. What did you pay for the two guys in the yeshiva? $2,000? You got $200 million. Do you still owe the reward for the next world or no? Or you got more than enough? This is your homework. This is your homework. If you get a huge reward for something you did over here. That's what I just said. It's not the Rambam. It's the end of Parashat Vayetchanan. The last three verses on Parashat Vayetchanan is that Hashem pays the righteous later. He delays the reward for 1,000 generations. And pay the wicked cash to their face to get rid of them. I will not delay the reward of the wicked. I will pay them instantly to get rid of them. Meshalem l'arasha el panav le'avido. To wipe him out. It's a clear verse in the Torah. By the way, if you're clever, this verse is, you know, you're not allowed to compare verses in the Torah because every word there is divine. Don't get the wrong impression here. But this is one of the most influential verses in the Torah. If you're clever, if this verse would not be in the Torah, we would be in a very big problem when it comes to faith. This verse put everything in the right place. Exactly. Why? Because how many times people ask why wicked people celebrate and gain while righteous people suffer and seek and don't have? That's a very big question that everybody asks. Jews, non-Jews, religious, not religious. Everyone asks. I'm sure they ask in a church and they ask that in a mosque. And they ask it in a synagogue, and they ask it on the street, everywhere. How such a horrible person makes so much money, and such a nice person doesn't have money for rent?
immediately it brings people to a mistaken conclusion, to the wrong conclusion. There is no supervision. Maybe there is a God. Maybe he made the world. Maybe there's no God. I don't know. But one thing I am sure, that there's no justice. And therefore, I better be a villain. Steal as much as I can, hurt as much as I can, grab as much as I can before it's too late for me. That's the conclusion of 99.999999% of the people in the world. And the reason they all have this conclusion, because they never read those three verses in the end of Parashat Va'etchanan. If they would read it, they would never begin to think so crooked. Because the Torah says clearly, it cannot be more obvious. Those who I hate, those who are wicked, I pay them right away for what they did right. In this world, to wipe them out. Clear verse. Clear verse. There's no way to different interpretation. Rashi writes clearly. Pay them in this world to get rid of them for the next world. But you don't even need Rashi. It's clear in the verse. However, to the righteous, I delay the reward. Delay to when? To Christmas time? To when? Delay to when? I don't see any righteous get his reward. Learning Torah 50 years, what is it? He's still driving an electric bike. I don't. Where is the Bentley? Where is the house on a shore of Great Neck? Where is the nice boat? Where is the steaks? Where is the nice, delicious fish? Where is the five maids? Where is the private jet? Where are all these things? Look, all his life reading, enjoying, reading. But come on, where is the reward? If the learning of Torah is the highest value, every learner should have been Donald Trump multiplied by a million financially. No exaggeration. Everyone, every Talmid Yeshiva should have been, but most of the Talmid Yeshiva are not even near what he has. And he cannot be the toenail, the dirt of their toenail in the spiritual value. Not him and not any other president. So the question is, where is the reward? Not in this world, the Torah say. To the righteous, it's waiting for later. To the wicked, it's right away. Just like a father who has two sons, he said to one of them, you can get $1 now for what you did, or you can get next week $100. The dumb say, I want now $1. The smart say, next week, give me $100. In America, they have a say. It's called penny wise, dollar foolish. You heard that expression? This is one of the first things they taught me in America in 1990. Don't be penny-wise, dollar-foolish. Penny-wise, when it comes to pennies, it's very smart. When it comes to dollars, it's very dumb. Meaning, when it's not important, he knows to make the right decision. When it's important, he always do what's wrong. Same thing over here. When it comes to life of eternity, we make every mistake that is possible. When it comes to a blink of the eye, a temporary life of a year, we put so much thinking and so much efforts to design the tent that we'll have here today and tomorrow we'll fly with the wind. Invest in a temporary place and neglect the permanent place. Just like someone give you a room in some lousy motel for 1 week until your beautiful mansion will be ready. And they give you in the meantime $10,000 to survive. And what do? Paint the motel room, bring chandelier, change the mattress, change the rug. They come to the room. Wow, what did you do to the room? I invested all $10,000 in a room. Yeah, you fool. What is this room for you? You're soon going into your mansion for 40 years. This is what you burn your money on this temporary motel room? That's the point of life. He invest all his efforts in this stupid world, and in the end, he comes to the next world naked, zero. No reward, no merits. Bezrat Hashem will be wise, We will always make the right choices. It's not easy, but if we learn Torah daily, slowly, slowly, our computer will adjust correctly and will choose always what's right. For that, we need the right hashkafa, the right ideology. Thank you very much. Baruch Adonai leolam. Amen ve'amen. Rabbi Hananya ben Akashia, Omer, Atzah, Kadosh Baruch Hu, lezakot et Yisrael.